Logan. I'm Diego, developer advocate here at Scaleway, and I'm joined by Pete from this company called Ampere. You folks work with these chips called, that work on this architecture called ARM that I've been hearing all about, and I'm actually using all the time. I have two devices with me, my cell phone and my clock right now, and they are everywhere. Now they are in the data centers. So yeah, can you tell me about, first of all, Ampere, and then what ARM is, and why is it becoming so relevant in the data center nowadays?
Okay, yeah. Ampere. So I'm quite a long-lived employee. I've been with them just over 2 years now.
All right.
And we're growing quite quickly. We're a silicon startup. We are a silicon design company that started 6 years ago. Quite a small team, and have grown steadily, well-funded, and with the right vision and at the right time. I'm sure you've been aware that there's been various previous efforts from companies for ARM at data center class. And we think that the ingredients have come together at the right time and at the right scale for Ampere to make a successful job of putting ARM in the data center. And I'm sure you've seen some of the announcements that we've had over the last year and this year.
And just today.
And just today.
With Scaleway.
Just today with the COP ARM 1 instances and the previewing that you've been doing with ARM. So thank you for that.
Of course. No, thank you for all the work that you've been putting out there and for coming here to share with us.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
So, yeah, ARM, an architecture that we've been hearing about a lot lately, but somehow I think that it's still scary for some of us developers who are used to using just x86 or Intel and your AMD CPUs.
Yeah.
So, yeah, what's the deal? I know that a Raspberry Pi, my Raspberry Pis are running ARM processors, but yeah, that's it. Now, the way I interact with them is through the operating system that's installed there. But how do I make sure that this is something that I can rely on in a bigger setting?
Sure. That's a good question. So ARM has been around a long time. It came out of a British development company for home computers, and a couple of architects started it off, Steve Ferber, Sophie Wilson. They've gone down into the annals of computer history now.
Yeah.
And, you know, really it's been an amazing story of an architecture that has proved power efficient from the start and to be right-sized for the job that it tackles. So, you know, through the years, it's been enhanced to cover mobile phones. And now that it's in pretty much every mobile phone and a lot of client computers, as we've seen with Apple adopting ARM since the M1, it's pretty much now the most developed on computer architecture in the world. It's certainly one of, if not the most numerous computer architecture chip in production, and probably will continue to be, certainly in the mobile space. And now, you know, after these efforts, after the software ecosystem has been put in place, converting over x86 applications, traditional applications, over to the ARM instruction set. Now you see it's set to begin that J curve rise in the data center as well, as being the right sized architecture for the job.
I think, yeah, that thing that you just mentioned, the software part, the software support part, I know there have been a lot of single board computers out there in the market from different manufacturers, but let's go with Raspberry Pi, the most popular one. What do you think that happened Yeah, what do you think happened that made Raspberry Pi the most popular one when compared to the other set of competitors?
Sure. So, you know, there's the kind of the romance almost of how the Raspberry Pi started off as a great story,
yeah.
But in the footsteps of the BBC B microcomputer,
yeah.
this was an 8-bit computer from the 1980s. But it's not only just the origin story, which is interesting in itself, but it's the amount of developer support that makes a difference. And the number of people and the gravity that creates for even more people to get involved. And that's what's led to the success of the Raspberry Pi. And when developers talk about their involvement, then companies take notice. So suddenly you see the Raspberry Pi as an ecosystem,
right? Yeah,
was suddenly supply constrained because you know, they were so popular in commercial deployments as well. And you know, we've just seen in the last maybe couple of days news come out that the Raspberry Pi had been used in a high altitude balloon experiment from NASA that was flying around the Earth, and they lost their Starlink data feed just after launch. They lost other downstation links because they were flying over places within downstation link range so few times. But they had four or five Raspberry Pis aboard, just logging terabytes of data, and those things were just dropping on parachutes. This is digressing a little bit from our main topic, but the thing that creates that difference is the weight, the keenness of developers to give of their own time.
Yeah, the ecosystem that it creates.
Exactly. Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah. And that, you know, that's been something that's been really important.
Mm-hmm.
As important as getting the right floor plan on the silicon for Ampere, as important as getting the firmware right so that DevOps and people who manage data centers can manage those Ampere machines in the same way. It's been the attitude that we don't just throw silicon over the wall at our partners who build platforms. It's that we get involved and that we support a software ecosystem. So we are committing to the Linux kernel.
Right.
We are committing to both distros and projects, you know, that support building large-scale data center infrastructures, things like Openstack, for example, and you know, just to give developers that trust that when they land their configurations, their Terraform, their code, and their functions on software that should be running on ARM, that software application, be it a web in-memory database or back-end database or S3 storage, all of that is working. So, you know, we do spend time running continuous integration, deployment and test, and then publishing those test results so that developers can see it, so that we can play our part in creating that weight of developers in the ecosystem.
Again, the ecosystem. Great. Now, let's talk about the topic of today.
Sure.
AI Pulse, right?
Yeah.
So, inference. What's inference? Let's start with that, because people
sure.
have heard or have read about training models and all that,
yeah.
But sometimes the word, the keyword inference, mm-hmm. is just skipped, right?
Sure, yeah. So, a model... is a network of connections. Mm-hmm. And many beautiful ideas are contained within those models in order for them to capture behaviors, in order for them to be able to reflect the world from which, reflect the data from which they've been trained. But training is probably less than half of the job. And, you know, we all hear about the supply shortages with getting models trained and the massive expense for training. Well, you know, if we're running a commercial system here, if we're developing functions for customers, functions for citizens, those models have to go out into the real world and be used.
Exactly.
So that's where inference comes in. So inference is much less heavyweight in terms of maths operations for a computer to be able to perform. But when you do inference, generally it has to be very timely. You know, if you're inferring in a picture from a video camera, what is pavement, what is roadway, what is car, and what is pedestrian?
Quite important.
It's quite important. You know, you cannot do that in non-real time. You have to do that in real time. If you're working with speech-to-text models, you know, maybe there could be, as we're speaking to each other,
the subtitles that you're seeing right
there
here.
There could be subtitles down at the bottom. Well, if we were broadcasting live, we would want those subtitles to be delivered in a timely manner.
Exactly.
They would need to be real time.
Yeah.
And that used to be done by a person, a stenographer, typing shorthand on a very specialized typewriter, and that took years to do. However, that might not be the case anymore. So models like Whisper, it's important when Whisper is run in inference mode, that can keep up with the rate with which, you know, that I'm speaking at.
The application needs.
Yeah. So inference is about using using the data. And in terms of compute investment, in terms of the cost of compute, we and kind of the rest of the industry uses a rule of thumb that you will spend about 85% of your outlay on the long tail of inference that is done for your model that you've trained. So maybe 15% of the cost is the creation of the model, 85% is the cost of the inference of the model. So with that majority of the cost there, it then becomes important to be able to process that inference in as efficient a manner as possible.
Of course, that's part of your product.
Exactly, yeah. It's always possible to do it efficiently. And it's always possible to do it accurately. But is it possible to do it efficiently, accurately, and with low latency in a timely manner? You know, it's one of those Venn diagrams. You can have pick two.
Yeah.
So, you know, one of the things that we've been working with at Ampere is enabling a processor, a socket, to have enough compute on board so that it can process the number of tokens in real time for speech transfer, for recommendation engines as well, and now for large language models. And to do that in an efficient manner so that you're not having to spend the power budget that you might on GPUs or more specialized silicon ASICs, application specific integrated circuits. They can be quite high power.
Yeah, quite expensive.
And more expensive, somewhat. Also have an eye to the latency. So by keeping that inference processing on chip and not having the expense of other PCIe devices having to pick that up from DMA or whatever, then that becomes a really interesting thing for having low latency and low power in the same package.
Right.
So that's why we put ourselves in the frame for many inference tasks, because there's a sweet spot of low latency, real-time results, and low power.
Great. Now we come back to the point that we made earlier. That's the community.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen the documentation. It's pretty good. And I've also seen that you have packages like PyTorch and TensorFlow,
mm-hmm.
specifically made and empowered for the ARM CPUs that you create.
That's right, yeah.
So
we do, yes. Onyx as well. I've been talking about some of the models that are supported. When it comes to being Europe specific, then for the French language, Mistral,
mm-hmm.
Is also something that we're seeing good performance on for the large language model size. One of the things that we also did was kind of put ourselves in the place of the developer.
Right.
Really focus on ease of use. What we don't want to force on a developer is something that is so particularly architecture specific that it becomes a bind, that it becomes a kind of a lock-in, as it were. So, we have commits to both kernel and work in TensorFlow, PyTorch, so that the architecture advantages are reflected in the code base for those. But what we also do is have AIO, AI optimization.
Right.
As a package, you can imagine that as easy to use as a math kernel library. So it sits under there, underneath your model, mediating between the kernel and the actual execution of the model during an inference run, and is aware of the instructions that are contained within Ampere's ARM compliant architecture. So it's performing those pieces of acceleration in the depths of the core on each of our sockets, or the many cores, up to 128 cores, maybe, and it's doing that without the developer having to get involved.
Right.
And so the way because that allows us some flexibility, because we're sort of agnostic of the way that we're deployed.
Right, you don't want to create another barrier for people.
Exactly.
In order to just move from from an architecture to another one.
Sure.
Right? Just focus on your code, on what you know to do.
Then
just migrate, because you see the benefits of this new architecture.
Yeah. Exactly. So the way we deliver that is just in a really multifaceted way. It old style. It could be bare metal or virtualization.
Right.
But more commonly, people are just pulling down our Dockers and running in containers.
Mm-hmm.
We're agnostic about that.
Yeah, I tried that actually. It was just pulling the container, pulling the image, running the container, and that was it.
Cool.
Yeah, amazing. All right. So thank you so much for sharing all this information with us. Thank you for being here at the conference.
Okay.
I hope you continue enjoying the conference, and hope to see you next time in another maybe live stream or webinar.
Any
or
song.
Anything that we can come up in the future, because we like to continue this partnership for
Cheers.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you.